Welcome to the broadcast. The battle between the president and the independent counsel Ken Starr continues today. Sid Blumenthal, a White House aide, came to the grand jury to testify about conversations he may have had with journalists. We'll consider that tonight.
If, in fact, there is something going on at the White House, an effort to find out things about the prosecutors in Ken Starr's office, to rattle them, to throw them off their game, to impede the investigation, it is perfectly legitimate to investigate it.
Ken Starr wants to answer something Sid Blumenthal has said. He's got ways to answer, but the one way he's not allowed to answer is to use the grand jury to haul him in.
What does Sidney Blumenthal do that warrants being called before a grand jury? What is the crime that is being investigated here? I mean, what is this man doing? He seems to be overreaching. He seems to be spiteful.
And a conversation with one of the big stars of the hit movie Titanic, Gloria Stuart.
Charlie, it's impossible to describe it. I mean, limos have come into my life. Couturiers have come into my life. Diamond merchants have come into my life. A couple of old beaux have come into my life.
We conclude with the ideas and opinions of the very talented and gifted Stanley Crouch.
We work very hard on these shorter pieces in order to try to create the level of pleasure that arrives from a certain quality of writing. See, even people who don't like what I say often will say in reviews that, you know, you may not like what this guy is saying, but this guy knows what he's doing.
The grand jury investigates, Gloria Stuart talks, and the opinions of Stanley Crouch when we continue.
Charlie Rose is made possible by a grant from USA Networks as part of our continuing commitment to innovative television. Through USA Network and the Sci-Fi Channel, we provide original entertainment to America and the world. Charlie Rose is also made possible by these funders.
And by Bloomberg, a provider of multimedia news and information services worldwide. From our studios in New York City, this is Charlie Rose.
White House communications aide Sidney Blumenthal appeared before a federal grand jury today in the Monica Lewinsky investigation. Blumenthal, a longtime journalist for The New Yorker, The New Republic, and The Washington Post, joined President Clinton's staff last summer. He was subpoenaed by independent counsel Kenneth Starr to answer questions about his conversations with members of the media. After his brief testimony, Blumenthal spoke before reporters.
Prosecutors demanded to know what I had told reporters and what reporters had told me about Ken Starr's prosecutors. If they think they have intimidated me, they have failed. And if any journalist here or elsewhere wants to talk to me, I'll be glad to talk to you.
Joining us now for a consideration of this latest turn in the Starr investigation, Richard Cohen, a columnist for The Washington Post, John Podhoretz, editorial page editor for The New York Post, and Floyd Abrams, a constitutional lawyer for No Post. I am pleased to have them here. In a column in The New York Post, this is what Mr. Podhoretz said. Starr wants to know if this amounts to a conspiracy to impede his investigation. He has every right to do so. We hope he gives Sid Blumenthal the business. Somebody should. So this is okay with you, drag Mr. Blumenthal in before a grand jury and find out what journalist he's talking to.
Well, let me put it this way. That sentence came at the end of an editorial in which I revealed what I take to be Sid Blumenthal's perfidy and ill behavior as a journalist prior to his becoming a public official. I don't actually know how he has conducted himself as a public official. I do know, however, that the U.S. Code says that, you know, whoever corruptly, by threats of force, attempts to impede an officer in or of any court of the United States, you know, the due administration of justice shall be followed. And therefore, if in fact there is something going on at the White House, an effort to find out things about the prosecutors in Ken Starr's office, to rattle them, to throw them off their game, to impede the investigation, it is perfectly legitimate to investigate it. What's more, being hauled before a grand jury is not the same as being indicted. It's not the same as being hauled before a court. You know, in the years before Ken Starr, millions of independent counsel hours were spent before grand juries by millions of people. Nobody complained about going before a grand jury. You don't have to have a lawyer. You can go in and answer questions and leave. It's really not that big a deal.
What's going on with Ken Starr in your judgment? I mean, why is he so worked up over the fact that he's getting some criticism?
Well, because the White House has declared war on him, and I don't know what it is that he thinks has been said about him in these conversations that is so destructive, because I haven't heard them. But I take it that, you know, he's not a fool, and I don't think that, you know, that he's simply done this to give himself the kind of trouble that he's about to get into once you turn to the other panelists here.
Okay. I wasn't setting you up. Here's what you say. I agree with Blumenthal. Starr is abusing his power.
Yes, indeed. I think he is clearly abusing his power. In the first place, it is not nothing to be called before a grand jury. I mean, you'd be a fool not to show up with a lawyer. This is the second day in a row Sidney has had to take a lawyer with him. That is what? Floyd, you would know. $1,000, $2,000. It's quite intimidating.
An hour or a day? Well, depends on the
well for Floyd, it would be an hour, you know, but these are Washington prices. And it would be somewhat less. So, you would be intimidated if you're in that position, say, do I take this call? Do I talk to somebody? I am somebody who's talked to Sid and his capacity as a White House official, my capacity as a newspaper columnist, which is to talk to a wide variety of people and find out what's going on so I have an informed opinion.
Did he initiate the call or did you initiate
it? I'm not going to say who did what to who here in this case, but Sid had to turn over my name, I know, to Ken Starr, and Ken Starr is now going to ask him, what did you tell Richard Cohen if he wanted to ask that question? I think that's intimidating. And thirdly, you said Ken Starr's no fool. You can't prove it by me. I don't know what he's doing. What did Sidney Blumenthal do that warrants being called before a grand jury? What is the crime that is being investigated here? I mean, what is this man doing? He seems to be overreaching. He seems to be spiteful.
Is there a possible crime here, Floyd?
There better not be. I mean, it better not be criminal to criticize the Office of Independent Counsel. I mean, what sort of country is it? He is there because he criticized Ken Starr and people on his staff. That's why he was there. He was there because he took a bad position, a critical position. You're not allowed to use grand juries for that. I mean, it's wrong to do it, but it also seriously implicates First Amendment values.
But do you
because
know that
what he's doing? Yeah, because I heard Ken Starr on television explain that a torrent of lies had come out about his office. Use a grand jury because you say, as a public official, that someone else is venting lies about you? I mean, it couldn't be wronger from a First Amendment perspective. Ken Starr wants to answer something Sid Blumenthal has said. He's got ways to answer, but the one way he's not allowed to answer is to use the grand jury to haul him in, and it is hauling him in, to question him about what did you say to a reporter and what did a reporter say to you. I mean, I don't think it's a hard call. It's not just foolish. It is foolish. It's silly. It's harmful to Starr on the investigation, but it's worse than that. It's dangerous. We don't want to punish people, even in the White House, because they say things which are critical of prosecutors. It's wrong. And it imperils the First Amendment.
And what's the next step? The next step could be to subpoena reporters and say, what did Sidney Blumenthal say to you? And let me tell you something, as a reporter who's been in that position, I've been subpoenaed in cases like this, your phone goes dead. It goes absolutely cold. You cannot function.
I've always thought, Richard, that the first person to go to jail on this whole matter is going to be some client of mine. It's not going to be the president, and it's not going to be John Podhoretz.
You know,
it's going to be some client of mine who's not going to testify because he thinks the First Amendment ought to protect him.
People are talking about Sid Blumenthal as though he were a reporter being hauled up before a grand jury, as opposed to a public official on the taxpayer's dole. And if he is spreading defamatory information from the White House, from his phone at the White House, you're damn right it's deserving of investigation.
Well,
that's not a First Amendment.
Let Ken Starr sue him for defamation.
It is not. I mean, that's a very fair articulation. Assume he's spreading defamatory information. Maybe it's true, maybe it's false.
Right. Well, you don't know.
When did we start using grand juries to investigate the spread of information to have a prosecutor decide what is political truth or not?
When in the history of the United States has a White House declared war on a criminal investigation of itself?
When has there ever been a criminal investigation like this one?
There never has been.
But John, every criminal investigation I've ever known about in Washington is political, in which people on both sides leak to the press and try to destroy each other in the press. The game has been played this way ever since I got to Washington, and that's 30 years ago. It was true in Watergate, it was true with Agnew, it was true with every one
of them. But you know that what has gone on here, this is an entirely unprecedented situation. Every day things are happening that have never quite happened before. The public nature of the investigation, the public nature of having reporters stand and camera crews standing outside, you know, a grand jury room waiting for people to come out who then, you know, either issue statements or don't issue statements. And the, you know, the very fact that the White House is conducting a public campaign to delegitimize the independent counsel's office, which is well within its rights, and I don't say that it isn't. The question is, how far is it going? If in fact the White House, as has been alleged, has hired private investigators, or someone has hired private investigators to find out dirt on Ken Starr's prosecutors, maybe he should better, I don't know what the procedures are, maybe he should better have gone to Janet Reno and said, you better investigate these guys because I can't.
Yeah, a valid point, but that's not the issue here, which is the issue here is not hiring private investigators, but the issue I understand, based on what this I've read and what he seems to have said, what he was asked about, is what conversations he had with reporters.
But it has to do with the dissemination, presumably, that those questions have to do with the dissemination of information in the course of those conversations with reporters, not simply the fact that he's talking to reporters.
Give me an example. What sort of information said to a reporter could be the proper basis of an obstruction of justice charge? Because they say Starr is overreaching, wrong, bad,
no,
evil,
that's
untrustworthy.
Opinion. That's opinion. That's opinion. How would it be if he said you should really look into the question of whether Prosecutor X, you know, was a child molester, and the prosecutor gets a phone call saying I hear you're a child molester. I mean that's how it would work.
Well,
obviously.
Well, just take that as an example. You wouldn't have any problem with that, would you?
I would not have a problem with that.
In terms of being brought before a grand jury.
Right.
I
would like very much to know, and we would know because it would have been said already by Blumenthal, if that's what he'd been asked. If what he'd been asked instead is, what did you say to this reporter? You spoke to Cohen? You, Cohen, on the phone together? What'd you say? What did he say? What business is that? Especially, I mean, in particular, because it is critical of Starr. That's all the more reason why Ken Starr should not be asking.
If he hauled Richard or me up before a grand jury and demanded what we knew from Sid Blumenthal, that would be illegitimate. The relation of Sid Blumenthal to journalists as a public official is a different one.
But I think Sid Blumenthal's got First Amendment rights, too.
Well, of course he has First Amendment rights, but he
what
also...
What rights does he have left if he can be called up in front of a grand jury and questioned about this?
Oh, come on. Calling someone up before a grand jury is not a violation of his First Amendment rights?
Well, I think it is. I think
on what grounds can you call him
about political speech?
Yeah, so let him say...
Particularly if you do it for the purpose of suppressing it. I mean, after all, well, what do we think? Why is this really happening? What's really going on? We don't know, but what do we surmise?
What do we surmise?
It's designed to prevent it, to stop it, to punish it. All the
so Starr wants to say, in your words, to any White House person who may be calling up reporters
right.
and saying, get this bad information about, or stop doing whatever you're doing. That's the purpose of it.
Stop calling Cohen.
Yeah.
Stop calling the Washington Press Corps. And if you do, stop saying bad things about
me. If that's true, if that's mm-hmm. the purpose, would you object to that?
Well, let's pull back in a Machiavellian sense. If what you have here is the White House has decided that an investigation into potentially criminal behavior by the president is a political war, and they have therefore engaged the investigator in a political piece of political combat, if he fires back by hauling someone before a grand jury, not indicting someone, not making them a target of an investigation, but merely saying, come before the grand jury to answer some questions, maybe to make him uncomfortable,
do I think
that's an abuse of power? It would be, it's ugly, but the entire game is ugly.
But he made him produce records first. He made him produce his phone records. The power of the grand jury is enormous. That's why he can get away
Not
with
his
this.
Phone records. They're White House phone records.
The records
he is a
his,
public official.
Yes.
He is a public official on the public payroll.
Engaged in First Amendment activities.
That's right.
Advocacy.
What has he done? I mean, what is it?
Why are you assuming that the investigation into him is criminal?
I read Starr's statement.
Right. So did I. But he didn't say that he didn't say that Blumenthal was a
criminal. But what is the connection with a crime? Well, I mean, this is a grand jury. You say, show up or else. Or else I come and I put the cuffs on you. And if you don't answer truthfully, you've perjured yourself. And if you don't answer, you're in contempt. This is serious stuff.
Yeah. And if the topic is what Ken Starr said it was, which is a potential obstruction of justice. Mm-hmm. Blumenthal, not Clinton. Mm-hmm. Blumenthal and whoever is with Blumenthal.
As a public official working for
obstructing
Clinton.
Obstructing justice by what?
Whose position
speech.
And power and authority flow through the President of the United States as an official
about
of the
Starr.
Executive branch.
But he is.
That's the reason
thing
Starr should stay away.
Another thing
not
that bothers me
close.
About this is that Sidney Blumenthal and the President of the United States occupy political positions. Mm-hmm. Ken Starr does not. If they want to get into a political fight with him, fine. But he shouldn't get into a political fight with them. He's a prosecutor. They occupy different positions. Every investigation I've ever known about has played politics. Agnew did it. Nixon did it. They all went after the special prosecutors.
Is part of your objection to this simply because you don't like Blumenthal?
Of course, I admit that freely.
The idea that he is said to be the person, as Maureen Dowd said, they call him Grassy Knoll at the White House, and that he is a person who evidently...
I don't know this is true, Charlie. He doesn't like him because he disagrees with him.
No, I don't like him because he's in print. He has said extremely ugly and nasty things about people that I like and admire and I'm even related to. And therefore, I don't like him, and I'm happy to see him go through trouble. I freely consent that I'm an editorialist, and I can say, and I agree with that. But people like that, people like Sidney Blumenthal, did not object when other independent counsels were hauling people that he disagreed with up and doing much, much, much worse things to them than he is doing, than Starr is doing to him. And, you know, and therefore right. turnabout may be fair play in
do you
instance.
Think Starr should resign?
Absolutely.
Floyd? For this?
Let me say, I like Ken Starr. I know him. He was a good First Amendment judge. He was.
Strong on the First Amendment when he was Solicitor General?
Yes. Yeah. And even more when he was a judge.
So what do you think is going on?
On his own. What do I think is going on? I think the Office of Independent Counsel, not just Ken Starr, has become persuaded that anything goes to get this president. Yeah. And that is an unacceptable
is it also
matter
fair,
of thought.
Is it fair to say that there is a concerted campaign in and out of the White House to say anything goes to get Ken Starr?
Sure. To try to bring him down.
Right.
I'm not passing on what's true and what's false, but has this become a sort of war? Sure, it's become a sort of war. The difference is there are some limitations on Starr. He's not allowed to leak grand jury information.
Right.
But he's not allowed to misuse the grand jury process in a fashion that I'm afraid he has here.
Monica Lewinsky, what is the latest word as to what she is going to do and whether she's going to deny or whether she's when is she going to come to the grand jury?
What talk shows is Ginsburg on tonight? I heard he's doing the Robin Bird show.
Richard Cohen, Floyd Abrams, and John Podhoretz, thank you very much. We'll be right back. Stay with us. In her 87 years, Gloria Stuart has assumed many identities. She has been a Hollywood film star of the 1930s, a painter who made a sellout debut in New York, a book artist whose handmade books are collected in museums, and an activist who helped found the Screen Actors Guild. She is a mother, a grandmother, and a great-grandmother. But it is her role as Rose Calvert in the film Titanic that is gathering her unprecedented attention. She has been nominated for a Golden Globe and an Oscar for Best Supporting Actress. I am very, very, very pleased to have her at this table. Welcome.
Oh, it is such a thrill. It is such an honor, Mr. Rose.
I'm going to call you Gloria, and you're going to call me Mr. Rose. Can we get past that right now?
Yes, except Mama told me that when I first met someone, I should... I should say, Mr. All right. May I say Charles?
Please do.
Can I say Charles?
Charles. My mother would be pleased about that in heaven. She would
right.
say, finally, someone has said the name that I gave him.
Okay. Charles.
Tell me about the phone call. You're in Los Angeles. You're living in, what is it, Brentwood? Where do you live?
Yes, Brentwood.
And there is a phone message left for you. What does it say?
Well, I came in from my studio where I was printing, and it said, Lightstorm Entertainment, something about a location trip. Well, that sounded good because I like to travel.
Yeah.
And then it said Titanic, and I thought, And then it said Poland, and I thought, Poland, you know, why not Italy or France? Why does it have to be Poland?
The south of France would be very good for Gloria.
So, but I didn't know Lightstorm, and I hadn't worked in years. My agent took off for South America about 6-7 years ago. I never bothered to get another agent. So I called this wonderful friend of mine, Marvin Page, who knows all, and I said, Marvin, come over and translate this. He said, Lightstorm is a wonderful company. It's James Cameron. He's one of the
hottest
directors in town, and Titanic. And so he called, and the casting director got on the phone, and she said, may we come over and talk to you? I said, sure. So she came over the next day, and she had a video camera.
Yeah, right.
I'd never seen it. And her girl, Friday, sat there while she talked to me, interviewed me. I guess she wanted to see if I was still breathing. I don't know. So then she left, and the studio, Lightstorm, is only about 15 minutes away. So I think in about 45 minutes she called. So I think Cameron saw some of the film.
Yeah.
And she said, may we send a script over? And I said, oh, yes, please do, because it sounded wonderful.
Sure.
So they sent a script over, and in about 45 minutes again, by this time I'd done, you know, Old Rose. I didn't read the script. I just read Old Rose, and it was a wonderful part. Oh, I could taste it. Oh, it was just wonderful.
You wanted it.
Oh, and then she called and she said, Mr. Cameron wants to know if you will read for him tomorrow. I said, of course I will, of course. And then she called back in about 5 minutes and she said, Mr. Cameron wants to know if you will read for him without makeup. Evidently, they worried about my looking 102, which is very easy at this age. And I said, I started to say, because this is Groucho Marx's training, I'll read for him without clothes on if he wants it. And I said, no, I don't know her, and I don't know him. I mustn't say that. So I said, yes, please. He came over the next day, and here I'm very plain Jane, you know, and I have a little white cap on, no hair showing or anything. Yeah. And I read for him for an hour. And he only stopped me once, and he said, you sound very angry. And I said, isn't that the way you wrote it? And he said, well, no, I hadn't thought of it that way. It's the speech where I describe the 1,500 people in the water and the fact that there were lifeboats, 20 lifeboats around, and only one of them came back. I mean, the immorality of it was so shocking, and I was furious. And I said, how would you want me to read it more gently? He said, no, no. He said, read it the way you want to. That was the only time he stopped me. So the next day I left for England because I had booked passage and I have a lot of friends in London. Well, I call the reporter, I call Variety, I call my friends for 3 weeks. You know, has it come out? Has he announced it? No, so I cut the trip short. I came home.
He couldn't stand it.
And I wrote him a letter.
Yes.
I said, dear Mr. Cameron, I would like to read the script for you again, having read Young Rose as well as Old Rose this time. You know, I should have given you a feistier reading, and I would love to read for you again. That was Friday afternoon. Took it to the post office, did priority big. I didn't want it lost on his desk. And Tuesday morning, they called and said, how would you like to be Old Rose?
All right.
Hey!
Now, they loved, as I understand it, your voice. Your voice was young. It wasn't old.
That was his great genius. He said two things. Makeup, he said, don't touch her eyes. And then he used a word that I'd never heard. He said, because we're going to morph them. I thought, oh, what is that? You know, what? Lenses, you know. And then he also
not sure
said,
I want to be morphed.
Yeah, the first reading up in Halifax. And I was doing a quavery little voice. He said, Gloria, I want your voice. He said, I don't want an old voice. I want your voice. So I didn't have to walk away quavery anymore.
Now, how long had it been since you'd acted? I mean,
I had a good role with Peter O'Toole on television, my favorite year.
That was 19...
That was 7, 8 years ago.
Okay.
But it was the only one I've ever played where I didn't have any lines. But when my agent said, Peter O'Toole, no lines, she said, so I didn't. I said, you probably weren't. I said, please.
So you get on, you got the role in Your Old Rose.
Yes.
A central character, because that's the way the story is told.
Right.
How did you get along with Cameron on the set?
Beautifully. He's a wonderful
director. He's a sweetheart, isn't he?
Oh, he is darling.
Well, you
very,
know what they say.
In the first place, very rare for me in the early days, because most of the directors in the early 30s had been action directors. They had not been trained in theater, so they had dialogue directors. James knew what he wanted, and he was able to tell you what he wanted. And during the entire shoot, the only time he ever corrected me was, there's a scene where Louis Abernathy is explaining with great joy and joie about the sinking of the ship, and it gets, you know, and it goes down pretty neat, huh? And I said whatever I said to him, and James said, Gloria, you're being grand. I said, I don't want to be grand. But that's the only time. Oh, no, he was wonderful.
Yeah, but there was one time you refused to ride on the helicopter, didn't you?
Yes, but that didn't have anything to do with him being a director. He wanted me to land on this ship.
Or, right, at the beginning when they're setting up the story.
Yeah, but I said to him, James, I do not believe in the theory of the helicopter. Someday they're going to find out that it's, you
doesn't
know,
work.
They made a mistake. And it's, no, they wanted...
They may find out with one that I'm on.
Yeah, but it was, we had to land on that postage stamp of a ship deck. And it was the biggest helicopter in the world each
time. So how'd they get around it?
Should I tell?
No, don't tell. All right, don't tell. Okay, let's take a clip and let's see if you're one of the few Americans who have not seen this movie, which is heading to record.
No, today.
Today?
Today it went over the top. It will be the all-time grosser of all time.
All right, let's hear it for Gloria. Here it is, ready to go back to the Titanic. This is where you're asked by the exhibition leader if you're ready to remember your Titanic experience.
Oh,
here
yes.
It is.
These are some of the things we recovered from your stateroom.
This was mine. How extraordinary. And it looks the same as it did the last time I saw it. The reflection has changed a bit.
Are you ready to go back to Titanic?
Well, there it is.
The butterfly, Kate Winslet wears at the ball in her hair.
Right.
That's why I wore
it. You wore. Now, did you wanted to see Kate Winslet?
Yes.
To get a feeling for whether she looked what?
Well, you know, body language is very important in building a character. I was playing her. She wasn't playing me.
Exactly.
So I wanted to see her body language and how she phrased when she talked, how she phrased. So they arranged that she would come to my house for tea. I called my daughter and I said, you're coming to my house for tea? And she said, go down to the English bakery, get crumpets and everything. So I had this beautiful tea in the bar all spread out. And when she got out of the limo and started up my walk, I walked out and put my arms around her. And it was instant loving each other, instant admiration and affection. So I said to her, I have a wonderful tea for you, Kate. She said, oh, I'd love a drink. I said, oh, I have champagne
we'll
in the fridge.
In the tea.
That's my lifestyle. So we killed a bottle of champagne
right
in
there.
About an hour. With Jim's man with the audio cam video thing doing, you know.
Yeah.
And she told me her life story, and I told her mine. We had a wonderful time.
Well, what has happened to you since this phenomenon has hit the world, the movie Titanic?
Charlie, it's impossible to describe it. I mean, limos have come into my life. Couturiers have come into my life. Diamond merchants have come into my life. a couple of old beaus have come into my life.
Well, we've been thinking about you all along, Gloria. Thought I'd call and say hello.
91 years old, and as my friend said this afternoon, they never give up, do they, Gloria?
Well, might we ignite some new torch here?
It's possible.
Everything's possible.
Why not?
Why not? Exactly.
What is wrong with
you
that?
Only live once, right?
Right, and they were all adorable.
I'm sure they were, knowing you this short time. Let me show you another clip, because I want to talk now about your life.
Yes, sir.
I mean, you're getting lots of roles being offered, not all of them you like. You've turned most of them down. Because they wanted too much violence, too much this, too much that. Nothing like this that...
No. That, this part will never come again, I don't think. It hasn't... I haven't seen a role like this. Maybe Driving Miss Daisy.
Yeah, there you go. Jessica Tandy.
Yeah, but look how many years in between for old ladies. They just aren't around.
This is when you were in The Invisible Man with Claude Rains, the voice of Claude Rains here. And your character confronts her former love, who has become the Invisible Man. Roll tape.
I shall offer my secret to the world with all its terrible power. The nations of the world will bid for it, thousands, millions. The nation that wins my secret can sweep the world with invisible armies.
Jack, I want you to let my father help you. You know how clever he is. He'll work with you day and night until you find that second secret, the one that'll bring you back to us. Then we'll have those lovely, peaceful days again, out under the trees, after your work in the evening.
Your father, clever? You think he can help me? He's got the brain of a tapeworm, a maggot, beside mine. Don't you see what it means? Power. Power to rule. To make the world grovel at my feet.
Jack, listen to me. Listen. My father found a note in your room. He knows something about Mauna Kea even you don't know. It alters you, changes you, makes you feel differently. Father believes the power of it will go if you know what you're fighting. Oh, come and stay with us. Let's fight this thing out together.
Wow.
Whee!
Whee. You grew up in Los Angeles?
Yes.
Started making movies, what, in the
20s? 1932.
First movie in 32?
1932, yes.
How many did you make?
I think about 43, 44. In those days, there wasn't a union.
Yeah.
And I made 9 the first year, so I was really what we call doubling in brass on this stage and then running, changing clothes and on that stage.
Universal and Paramount both bid for your services.
Right.
You were a hot item.
Yes.
Then you kind of got turned off by the whole process of acting.
Yes.
What happened?
I wasn't given parts that were challenges or interesting. Girl reporters, girl detectives, society girl, girl overboard, Shirley Temple.
Girl this, girl that, girl there.
Shirley was wonderful to work with and a joy. And when I protested to Zanuck and I said, I'm a dramatic actress, Mr. Zanuck. I come from Molnar and Pirandello and Shakespeare in Chekhov, you know. Shirley Temple's sister, he said, Gloria, the pictures that you make, few hundred thousand, with Shirley, millions will see you. Do the picture. Well, in those days, you did the,
did the picture.
Right? She was lovely to work with.
Who did you most admire back then? Who were the people that you thought, wow, because Bogart was a friend of yours?
Yes.
Hepburn?
No, I didn't know Kate. She worked at RKO the same time I did, but she was a very private person, so I really, I met her and that was it.
Who were your best friends?
Now?
Well, then.
Oh, then? Well, they were all screenwriters, like Groucho Marx, because he had brought my husband out from Chicago.
Yeah.
And so I had 40-some-odd years of being with comedy writers and comedians. You know, Fred Allen, Georgie Burns, Milton Berle, everybody. And what was wonderful about those parties, and they were very simple parties. They weren't big things. Because Groucho was the catalyst, and they adored him. And he asked them over all the time, entertained. And he and my husband were best friends. So I listened to these wonderful stories of these. They were poor boys. Most of them had never gone through grammar school. Georgie Jessel, Milton Berle, all of them. And they loved entertaining each other. You thought that was tough and vulnerable. Wait till I tell you. Oh, that was nothing. When I was there, you know, and it was evening after evening for 40 years. Now, what the tragedy was, there were no tape recorders. Yeah. And nobody wrote these gorgeous stories down, or these wonderful jokes, or the great humility and humor that these men had about themselves and the world. It was wonderful.
You were also friends with some literary figures, too, were you not?
One darling little story. One Christmas Eve, I went by Benchley's little house, and he had a Christmas thing out, and so I knocked on the door, and I said, Merry Christmas, happy. And he said, great. I said, who are you having Christmas dinner with? And he said, no one. And I said, what do you mean, no one? Now, here was the most adorable, eligible bachelor in Hollywood, musing, handsome, adorable. I said, I don't believe it, Bob. He said, it's true. So I said, well, it's only Arthur and myself and my mother. Will you come and have Christmas dinner with me? He said, I'd love to. I don't think it was 2 minutes. I was back in my villa, and he called and he said, Gloria, could Charlie come? Now, that was Charlie Butterworth, his best friend, yeah, next door. I said, of course, I'd love Charlie. So about 15 minutes later, he called. He said, Dottie wants to come, too. That's Charlie Parker.
Yeah, right.
Okay, so the three of them come, and I said to Mama, Mama, Dorothy Parker, Benchley, Butterworth, right, you know, adorable best friends. You'll love it. So she comes, you know, with a little satin blouse and the suit and the pearls, and she's sitting there waiting for Dorothy Parker. Dorothy came in black stockings and a black skirt and a black blouse, not terribly pressed, and black hair and a black mood. She was very angry, whatever it was about, and she did not say anything funny the whole afternoon, and Mama kept doing this, waiting, nothing
came.
And of course, Bob was trying to placate her, and Charlie was just sort of sitting there having a wonderful time. But it was things like that that happened at the Garden.
Do you play poker?
Oh, please. I'm in a almost 50-year poker game.
Is that right?
And these were Julius Epstein, who, yeah, you know, wrote Casablanca with his brother, Nat Perrin, who was my husband's collaborator on the Marx Brothers, Norman Panama, you know, the, yeah, Road Pictures, right, Crosby, all these wonderful men, Mike Kanan, you know, all these wonderful men and their wives. We've been friends for over 50 years, and we play poker almost every Saturday night.
You cook or not? Somebody else cooks?
No, we've given that up now.
No, okay.
We bring deli.
When did you start painting?
About 1954. Our daughter was going to the Sorbonne, and Bogey had made Barefoot Contessa with Ava Gardner and been in Rapallo and Portofino,
yes,
and came back, and we wanted to go to Europe for a year or so. And he said, Portofino, Rapallo, you've got to go. It's wonderful. So we stopped by in Paris to see our daughter, and she took me to the Jeu de Pomme and the Orangerie. And for the first time, I saw the real thing, the great impressionists and post-impressionists. And I got hysterical. She took me up the ladies' room and stretched me out. It was just so overwhelming. And when I thought about it that night, I thought to myself, you have a year and a half in Europe. You can do it, Gloria. So when we got to Genoa and got our little villa in Rapallo, I drove in and I bought an Italian-English dictionary and a book in Italian, How to Paint, and an easel and canvas and paints and brushes, and I went home and I started painting in 54. I continued painting there for a year and a half, and back home, and I made my one-man debut at the Hammer Galleries, yeah, in New York in 61. Sold out.
You make these, though? This is what,
yes,
you do? You make these little books?
I print them. I set the type, and I wrote that one. It's the only one I've written, but I set the type, and I hand press. I have a hand press. I print it on the hand press, and then I have a binder, and she puts it together.
You're remarkable. Gloria, I thank you for coming to this podcast.
Oh, my pleasure.
You're a delight.
You are, too.
I look forward to seeing you on Oscar night.
Thank you so much.
Gloria Stuart, one of the stars of Titanic. Back in a moment. Stay with us.
Stanley Crouch is here. He is one of America's most outspoken social critics. Whether writing about jazz or the trial of O.J. Simpson, he maintains a keen line of questioning about the choices we make in all aspects of our lives. His new book of essays is called Always in Pursuit, Fresh American Perspectives, 1995 to 1997. He's my friend, a friend of this broadcast, and always welcome here at this table, especially tonight. Welcome, sir.
Thank you, Charles.
The two things that you most love in the world and understand and write best about, Albert Mary and Duke Ellington.
Well, yes, there you could say that. I mean, those are two of the things. Well, I know what Murray is doing. I mean, Murray is one of the very finest minds that America's ever produced.
Ever produced?
Oh, definitely. One of the most original. And all, not only is he an original mind, he also has developed very original ways of writing. You know, he's written books of essays. He's written a poetics of jazz called Stomping the Blues. He's written a literary theory called A Hero in the Blues. He's written a book called South to a Very Old Place, which was probably the first book written completely in the second person, not the one that the kid wrote, was it Bright Lights, Big City?
Right. Jay McInerney.
Right. Not to smash him, but point of fact, Murray's book came out a long time before his. And he's written some novels. And
he's your intellectual godfather.
He's one of them. He's one of them. See, the essay that I wrote about him in here is one of the things I'm most proud of, because I invented a form to talk about him. And what I try to do in the book is invent these forms. All of the long essays, these forms are invented. There's something going on in just the way the essays are written, the way they're organized.
The manner of presentation has its own originality.
Right. See, for instance, with Murray, he has this base metaphor that he uses in one of his novels. So I start off the essay talking about the base, and then I show how the bass clef, which is the lower part of the orchestra, which is the South, right? Mm-hmm. How that works in his book, and how in his last novel, everything resolves back down to the bass. Whatever happens, it always goes back to the bass. And so that's different. Nobody's ever done that I know of.
Nobody's ever analyzed Murray that way.
Oh, the level I analyzed Murray on, his work has never been written about like this. I mean, nothing even close.
Where do you want to find your place? What do you want to be? What's your definition of Stanley?
I want to be good. See, what I'm trying to do in this book is give the reader the same thing I got when I read something that I liked. So I work very hard on these essays, and I work very hard on these shorter pieces in order to try to create the level of pleasure that arrives from a certain quality of writing. See, even people who don't like what I say often will say in reviews that, you know, you may not like what this guy is saying, but this guy knows what he's doing.
Yeah.
And everybody. That's something that I learned from people like Murray, Allison, Duke Ellington, James Joyce.
You gotta find a way, your own voice, and you gotta express it.
Plus the way you express your love for people is by giving them something of quality. See, the affection that you have for the public is shown by how much quality you're willing to give them. See, and oftentimes, as you well know from what you do, to give quality, that's costly. That's costly. You know, it's costly to give quality. And I'm willing to pay the cost.
Yeah, pay the price.
In terms of my own self, you know.
Me too. Now, but what it is that, what's the hardest part of the struggle for you to make that happen?
Well, I would say, right now it's not The difficulty that I have, if I can say it's a difficulty, is keeping up with my ability. See, I know how to do a lot of things.
Yeah.
Now, most people know me as an essayist, but I'm working on a novella now that if I bring off what I'm trying to do in it, it's going to bust this stuff open, because it's going to be about Americans who live the way they actually live. That is, no major American writer since World War II has successfully created a character out of another racial or ethnic group, so-called racial or ethnic group, nor have we gotten the sense of the variousness of human relationships that we actually live every day in the United States in writing. Now, television is ahead of fiction. Movies are ahead of fiction in that respect. I mean, fiction is way behind in terms of actually talking about how we live. The people who are on your crew here, they come from all kind of different backgrounds. Right. They know you, you know them, you travel through a varied world. You would be very hard put, Charles, to find a novel with a character like you in it, who travels through a world as varied as you do, who knows as many different kinds of people. And one of the things I've tried to do in Always in Pursuit is...
So this is a novel about me?
Well, that's my great novel, Charles. That's the great one I'm going to work on someday. See, I mean, I'm not ready for that. I have to be about 70.
Well, you need some... You've got some bases to touch, yeah. But go ahead.
But the thing is that's what we have to get now. See, we have to... As I say in Always in Pursuit, and this is what I want to do in everything. See, we all have very strong human connections that are undeniable. As Americans, everybody knows who we are. I've often said that if you put Louis Farrakhan and Patrick Buchanan on a plane and they were sneering and cursing at each other all the way to, say, Dublin, right. When they got off in Dublin, the Irish would say, ah, two Americans. If they then flew to Accra in Ghana, right? When they got off the plane in Ghana, the Ghanaians would say, ah, two Americans.
Yeah.
So there's something that hooks us all up that everybody recognizes except us. And see, what I'm trying to do is knock down all of these false definitions of alienation.
If I read this book, which I haven't read, as you know, Always in Pursuit, Fresh American Perspectives, will I know you from reading this book? Is this, you know, can I read this and know who Stanley Crouch is?
Well, let's put it like this. I doubt that you, Charles Rose, will know me that much better from reading this book.
Right, because I
know. Because you've known me for a long time.
That's right.
But somebody...
Known and loved you.
Somebody who has not read me before, they'll learn a number of things. First, they'll learn just the level of command
right.
that I have.
Of language and
I know
ideas.
How to do that.
Right.
And new ideas. And ideas that are extensions of my two principal intellectual mentors, Alvin Murray and Ralph Ellison, about whom not enough can be said.
Well, okay, but why do you think there's not more known about Albert Murray? He's been a guest on this program, been written about by Skip Gates, who endorses you, been written about by you in this book, and within an intellectual group is known well.
Well, see, quite frankly, I think that the level of sophistication that Murray really represents is beyond what most people, other than a guy like you, are really interested in when they look at somebody of his skin tone. Unfortunately, even for all that has happened in the United States, which is, you know, I mean, there have been monumental changes in this country. I point out in this book that probably the three most popular Americans are Oprah Winfrey, Colin Powell, and Michael Jordan.
Exactly right.
Now.
I know, I mean, I think about that a lot.
Right. Now, in 1960, it seemed, you know, people may forget this, but if they look at television or footage from television in 1960, they will get the impression that all things of importance were done by white guys in dark suits with dark, wearing dark white shirts and dark ties. Yeah. That is not true now. Today you have, you know, women governors, many black mayors.
More and more.
You have more. I mean, this you know, people have really moved this country far closer to its democratic ideal. But
that's what I want you to say. But
you see, in the intellectual arena, there's some sand in the Vaseline, as it were. See, Murray should be recognized the same way John Updike, Saul Bellow, a number of other people that are recognized.
Bull Finney plays the blues, John Ford and the meaning of democracy.
Right. Well, see, in that essay, I look at John Ford from an autobiographical perspective when I used to look at his movies as a kid over and over. Then I compare Will Rogers, who was one of his early, who was an actor in some of his Ford's movies, with Louis Armstrong. Then I compare Ford to Duke Ellington in terms of a guy who used a repertory cast, had basic themes, and continued to develop them throughout.
Let me come back to something you said, which I've thought about, as I said earlier. Michael Jordan, Oprah Winfrey, Colin Powell. Three of the most, I don't know of anybody who's in their pantheon of popularity in America.
Right. Who is?
How does that cut with clear racism that's still a part of the fabric of our society?
Well, I mean, the basic thing is this.
Does it say that we...
The fight is still going on. What I say to these people now, in one way or another, over and over, I say it in different essays, different ways, and always in pursuit, is this. See, we're in the corner. When you sit down in the corner on that stool, your head is ringing, and you are spitting blood in the bucket. But so is the opposition's head ringing and spitting blood in the bucket. Now, see, when we got in the ring, that is, those of us who, some of whose ancestors arrived as Africans, captured Africans, they came into the ring with both hands tied behind them, right? Eventually, we had one hand tied behind us. Now we have both hands free, and we're throwing punches. The result of those punches being thrown are people like Hazel O'Leary, Tom Bradley, mayor of Los Angeles for 16 years, this triumvirate of Jordan, of Winfrey, of Powell, of the fact that, because I mentioned one of the essays in there, some 10 years ago, they took a poll and asked families, if you didn't have your father, who would you prefer to be the father? And people said, Bill Cosby, right? So now what has happened, obviously, is that Negro Americans have moved from the condition of being buffoons, as depicted in the so-called golden age of Hollywood, into symbols of pure excellence in many, many situations. So what is important is to remind people, because, see, democratic morale is very, very important. See, you have a lot of people who will throw around names like Frederick Douglass and Harriet Tubman, and then come up with
W.B. Du Bois.
And then come up with some cynical, you know, America ain't never changed. It ain't never gonna change. It's the same change. Blah, blah, blah. Now, these people often are tenured professors at universities, by the way, making six figures and living in the suburbs with their wives driving Mercedes around while they're shopping and their kids going to private school. Now,
but when they sit down at that word processor,
yeah, or when they sit down here with you, they're gonna tell you, well, look at Brother Charles, I got to tell you, you know. Now, and see, the thing is, those people need to be pushed out of the discussion, or recognized as what they are, frauds.
Yeah, I know. You're the hottest place in hell for you. You reserve for posers, people who you don't think are authentic. I mean, hypocrisy rings large in your litany of sins.
Right. Right. But why shouldn't it?
Always in pursuit, fresh American perspective, 1995 to 1997. What I've tried to do this evening is just give you some sense of the range of the mind of Stanley Crouch, my friend. Thank you for joining us. We'll see you next time.
Charlie Rose is made possible by a grant from USA Networks as part of our continuing commitment to innovative television. Through USA Network and the Sci-Fi Channel, we provide original entertainment to America and the world. Charlie Rose is also made possible by these funders.
And by Bloomberg, a provider of multimedia news and information services worldwide.
To order Charlie Rose program transcripts and video cassettes, call 1-800-ALL-NEWS or write to the address on your screen. Please indicate show date and guest.
This is PBS.
Retrospectives of artists Chuck Close and Robert Rauschenberg. Next time on Charlie Rose.